Greetings. Welcome to you, Lucy Kaplansky. Thank you so much for joining us on this, our first episode of Richmond Sessions 2223. Richmond Sessions 2223, if I could just tell you just a little bit about it, features this recording space within the exhibition, Storied Strings, the Guitar in American Art, organized by the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts. This exhibition includes a little over 120 works of art and 34 guitars themselves, divided into 17 themes, ranging from politics, gender, blindness, to race and ethnicity. Linking these themes is the premise that the guitar, as a visual motif, has long enabled artists and their human subjects to tell stories that might otherwise go untold or undertold. This Richmond Sessions 2223, in turn, is a showcase for contemporary musicians like yourself to record songs to demonstrate the power of the guitar as a means for telling stories, invoking universal themes, and weighing in on myriad events. So thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for listening to my little filibuster there. How are you doing?
Good. I'm so excited to be here. This is exciting.
We're happy to have you here. I've really enjoyed diving into your discography and thinking about how you weigh in on myriad events. If I may ask you just a sort of abstract question.
Sure.
Is the guitar an expressive tool? Is that too weird? Is that too heady a thing to say? Can you communicate? Is the guitar, is it safe to call it a communication device?
Yeah. With the caveat that I don't consider myself a player, like I'm not a player the way a great guitar player is a player, or even people like who are just better guitar players than me. But there is no question, for me at any rate, that when I am trying to write something or just singing someone else's song, the guitar playing, the rhythm, the feel of it is absolutely an integral part of the expression of whatever it is. I mean, there's no question. It's become like, I don't think about it. Like, I don't have to think about what I'm playing. I don't have to think about what the chords are. It is such a natural extension of kind of my musicality. Like, it just, bam, happens. I don't know if that makes sense.
That makes perfect sense. Yeah, without getting too jargony, I think in the exhibition catalog, because I myself have been thinking of the guitar as a road that allows a message in the form of a car to drive. And so like a guitar as, well, some people here in marketing have been calling guitars storytellers' companions.
Yeah.
And so I know that we were talking a little bit ago about Bruce Springsteen, and I know you've covered Thunder Road, and there's that famous line, well, I got this guitar and I learned how to make it talk. Do guitars talk?
Yeah.
And anyway, tell me about that.
Well, it's funny, when I play that song a lot, I get a lot of requests for it, and when I get to that line, it's always kind of an exciting line to sing, because in the Springsteen version, he's someone, I don't know if it's him, actually plays a little solo.
Right,
that
right.
Moment.
They do a riff.
I don't do the riff, but I do an accentuated rhythmic thing. And in the same way, I think, yeah, in the same way that the voice talks, the singing voice talks, I guess, expresses, absolutely the guitar talks. I just wish I could make it talk the way someone like Nils Lofgren makes it talk. But
I think you do. Would you like to play us a song from Last Days of Summer?
Oh, yeah sure.
Did that come out in June?
It came out in June.
Okay.
I would love to. Yeah. And, you know, I guess I could just say in general, when I am writing a song, and I am not prolific, but when I work on it a lot, and when I'm writing, almost always, with a couple of exceptions when I wrote on the mandolin and maybe once or twice when I wrote on a piano, I'm writing on the guitar. And there's nothing like it in terms of bringing out whatever kind of unconscious ideas are in me. There's nothing like strumming or picking something and just singing words. And I couldn't do that without the guitar. I wouldn't just sing words without it. It wouldn't happen. So anyway, so this song definitely was one of those. Like I started playing some music and I started singing. This was about, I was writing this when our daughter was about to leave home to go to college, and I was just beside myself. I'm much better now, but that was a year ago, and I started singing. It was August or the end of July, and I started singing Last Days of Summer Coming on Fast, which just came out of me. I wasn't thinking about it. And here's the song. It's called Last Days of Summer. Last days of summer are coming on fast. Was hoping August wouldn't end, but it never lasts. She's filling boxes with blankets, books, and clothes. No longer a child, unafraid, ready to go. It's been 18 years since we fixed up that empty room. Pale yellow walls, pretty white crib, she'd be lying there soon. Then a bigger bed, games of pretend, and books and friends. Come September, gonna be empty again. After 18 years, how can it be just 1 week more till we carry those boxes to her new room on the 7th floor, across from the park where she played pretend and climbed and dreamed, where she flew high on the swings. Now she's gonna fly on her own wings, no longer pretending with her very own dreams. I remember the day I told my mom I wanna sing. She said, don't be a fool for a little girl dream. So I packed my things, looked back once, never did again. Afraid and defiant, was just 18 then. And I know she'll come back, but never always again. It's just as it should be and how it's ever been. But I'll miss that girl in her room, safe and mine. Life is a circle, strewn with goodbyes. After 18 years, how can it be just 1 week more till we carry those boxes to her new room on the 7th floor, across from the park where she played pretend and climbed and dreamed, where she flew high on the swings. Now she's gonna fly on her own wings, no longer pretending with her brand new dream. Just down the street and a million miles away. Hope her bed is soft enough. Hope at night she's not afraid. I hope her friends will be caring and kind. She's gonna make her choices just as I made mine. Last days of summer are coming on fast. Was hoping August wouldn't end, oh, but it never lasts. Come September, we'll be two, no longer three. Back where we started, back around that circle, darling, you and me.
Wow, thank you so very much. That's a wonderful song. It's
thank you.
I think a lot of us with kids going off to school or doing other things, coming of age, can very much relate to that. Do you think the guitar is uniquely poised in a way that other instruments aren't for communicating, for expressing as you just did? Could that have been done with the piano?
It would have been completely and utterly different.
Yeah.
I mean, piano, my friend John Gorka says, you actually sing differently when you sing at the piano. And it's true. So I've never really thought about it, but I think the music that comes out is completely different. And I was thinking as I was playing that song, there are weird unconscious things that happen when I'm trying to write and play guitar, and like that part of the song, fly on her own wings, da-da-da-da, on her own wings, no longer pretending with a brand new dream, which is just an ascending bass line.
Right.
And I didn't think about it. It just popped out of my fingers, and it was like, oh, where did that come from? That would be different on the piano. And then the obvious answer is that you can't carry a piano around with you. So
right.
You can be anywhere. Like, I have written so many songs in hotel rooms.
Sure.
So I think for portability,
right.
It's also pretty easy to play. I mean, it's not like a violin where you have to fret and stuff like that. You have to worry. I mean, there are no frets.
Yeah.
So it's very unique, I think, in terms of how it helps express music and ideas.
You have a PhD in clinical psychology.
Actually, technically, it's a PsyD, Doctor of Psychology, but close enough, it's a doctorate.
If the word affect means the outward projecting of emotion, of sentiment, there's a very strong, if it's not too cliche to say, a very strong psychological aspect to your playing. Can you talk a little bit about that moment in your life of becoming a psychologist and overlaps, carryover, between psychology and making music?
I was actually running away from the thing I really wanted, which was music. So I started out, I always wanted to sing from the time I was a little girl. And then by the time I was in high school, I was singing, performing for my high school and so on. And then I went to New York and I was doing really well. And I got a review in the New York Times when I was 21, a really good review. And then I just couldn't handle any of this, and I was too neurotic to kind of let myself go for it. And I quit, and I decided I was going to be a therapist. And so I went back to school, and then ultimately to clinical psych school. And then it was only after I became a doctor that I figured out, ironically, with the help of a really skillful therapist, that I was running away from the thing I really wanted, which was music. So I went back to music. But the things I learned so much between grad school and my own therapy. I learned so much about, I was able to put names on things that I couldn't quite understand, like human, kinds of conflicts. And I understood so much more in the wake of all that about motivations and conflicts, and not just my own, other people's. You see the world differently. You see people differently. My training helped me do that. And I think that absolutely affected everything about me, including writing. I mean, I think I'm a different person now. So the way I write, I think, is more just kind of wise and informed and insightful than it ever would have been without all that training. I don't know if that answers your question.
It certainly does.
You know, a lot of people ask me, is writing therapy for you? And I always say, no, therapy is therapy. Those are different things. Therapy is kind of, I guess, in the most simple versions, kind of uncovering unconscious conflicts and tendencies, and trying to relearn how to live in a different way.
Sure.
Writing is just expressing. I mean, maybe it's unconscious stuff that comes up, and I do believe that writing is very unconsciously driven. It certainly is for me. Like, I don't know where stuff is coming from a lot of the time, and I don't figure out what a song is about until it's almost done a lot of the time. But that's different from relearning how to, you know, how to avoid problematic behaviors. So I think they're really very different things.
Sure. I think the therapy maybe is for those listening to you, like art therapy, music therapy.
Oh, that's fair.
I mean, there's a type of outward, you know, catharsis and whatnot.
Yeah.
What would you like to play?
So something from the Red Thread. The Red Thread, that album is very close to my heart because it's partly about adopting our daughter. So our daughter's from China, our beautiful daughter. And I should just mention that all these songs are written with my husband. We co-write, which is kind of an unusual thing.
Can you tell us your husband's name?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Rick Litvin, L-I-T-V-I-N. He's a professor, a film professor at NYU. So he's not a musician, but he's got incredible gift for words. And needless to say, editing. He's a really good editor.
Sure.
So between those two things, we have written a bunch of songs together. And to some extent, we've written everything together. Mm. So anyway, I could play the song The Red Thread, which I started writing it actually on an airplane. Now, granted, I couldn't play guitar on an airplane, but I started writing the words on an airplane. And then, I don't know, I guess when I got home, I started to play it. And I was leaving my parents' house in California, and we were going to be adopting our daughter Molly, and I knew my parents were too old to ever travel again, and I wasn't sure they would ever get to meet her. And I was feeling incredibly sad. And maybe I'll say more about it after I sing the
sure.
song, but
sure.
So this is called The Red Thread. I was only a girl when I went out on my own. You wrapped me up warm and you just let me go. Now we live at the far end of this long distance line. Just another one is gonna left you behind. Wish we could look at your pictures, all the places you've been. You don't think you will, but you can see them again. Cause you can see them through me, the brown eyes I got from you. Now I wish I could give them back to you. This much I can say, this much I can do. When your heart is empty, I'll try to fill it for you. Cause I'm the girl who learned to love from watching you. Wish that I could tell you it'll all be alright, but you never did believe it through the trials of your life. And you and I both know it just isn't true. When so much you love has been taken from you. And I remember when you told me if we run out of time, how happy you were just to know she'll be mine. When I wrap her up warm, you'll be right next to me. Cause they say the red thread that ties me to you ties her to me. This much I can say, this much I can do. When your heart is empty, try to fill it for you. Cause I'm the girl who learned to love from watching you. La la la. la la la. Much I can say, this much I can do. When your heart is empty, I'll try to fill it for you. This much I can say, this much I can do. When your heart is empty, I'll try to fill it for you. 'Cause I'm the girl who learned to love from watching you. Watching you, watching you.
That's fantastic. I have so many questions for you about that.
Please ask away.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us. You're capoing on the second fret, so everything's up a step. One of the things that gets me in that song is when you say, I try to fill it for you, you go to A, well, I guess it's B there. And, you know, it's there's something about that, because you could do a minor chord there.
Wow.
But you do a major chord, and it really carries it.
Whoa.
And it kind of turns on the flashlight, and
God, that's a cool idea. I never thought about that.
I love that. I also love that you end on a C. Well, I guess it's technically a D. You end on the D
on the
and
four.
Not yeah, on the four and not the one. I know I've done that. Other people have done that. What does that do for a song, do you think? It kind of does. It leave things a little kind of like saying the narrative goes on, or what does that do?
That's
wow. So interesting.
That is a good question, which I've never thought about. I mean, it's a very different... I mean, it leaves it unresolved.
Right.
I mean, if you're ending on the four, you want to hear it go to the one.
Right.
Which I guess is emotionally very different. I mean, unresolved. So what does that mean? I mean, unresolved literally, musically, but unresolved psychologically, which God knows that song is about something that was unresolved, really.
Right. Well, for someone who says she's not a... You said something like you were saying that guitar, you don't see yourself as a mega guitar player. You have a lot going on there, and I think it's just...
Really?
I think you do, yes.
That's very kind
and I think
of
everyone,
you.
And I think everyone watching this would agree with that.
Really?
With that, too. Absolutely. I mean, I think that being an amazing guitar player is not about shredding or having a PhD in theory. I think there are different ways of doing that. The ascending bass line in the previous song, before you even said that, even one simple note, two, three, four simple notes... Or so, the guitar is your storytelling, narrative companion.
Well, let's put it this way. I mean, thank you. That's very kind. And people, I'm always amazed that people tell me they think I'm a really good guitar player because I just don't think of myself that way. To me, it's just like everything I do, I feel like is so simple. I do it well, but it's simple. But... there are little things I can do. Like in that song, there's also a descending bass line.
Yeah.
Which I guess that's really simple, but it's meaningful. It evokes something. I mean, I guess that's why I wrote it, because it was evoking something sad and... I don't know. It's going somewhere. It's heading somewhere.
Well, it is. But you musically, when you go from, I guess, like F sharp to E to D, which is, I guess, technically what you're doing there. I mean, you know, those are chord formations. They're not words.
Yeah.
But your fingers are moving.
Yep.
And you know, you do have a very effective matching of voice and guitar playing. You seem to, storyline-wise, thematically move as the notes move, and that's a good example of doing that. Can you give a little clarity to the thread metaphor?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I mean, I obviously looked at your bio on the web page, but I was struck by the red thread. I was struck that a little over a decade ago, you had two songs commissioned for a fragrance.
Right.
A fragrance line called Life Threads. Does that have anything to do with red thread?
So my understanding is that was La Prairie, which is a pretty big cosmetics company, and the president was a fan of mine. She came up with this idea of perfumes called Life Threads, and she was trying to think of a way to market it, and her husband, who was also a fan of mine, said, what about Lucy's The Red Thread, Lucy Kaplansky? And that's how I got involved. So it was an afterthought on their part, but it actually kind of was thematically consistent. It was fun, too. I never did anything like that.
Can you tell us a little bit about Kaplansky Sings Kaplansky?
Yeah. So
this is, for everyone watching, this is your dad, a mathematician.
Yeah, at the University of Chicago for many years. And then he moved to Berkeley to the Mathematical Sciences Research Institute, where he was director at the end of his life, toward the end of his
life. What's his name?
Irving Kaplansky. Okay. Yeah, so he was he's a very well-known mathematician, also a very talented musician. Left brain, all that stuff. I mean, I think it's really true. I was good in math too, a long time ago. And he played the piano really well. He had perfect pitch. So he was playing the piano all through my childhood, and he played the songs that he grew up with. And he was born in 1917, so it was like the 30s and 40s. So I remember a lot of those songs that he played, and then a lot of Gilbert and Sullivan, which he also grew up listening to. But then the other thing is that he wrote songs as a hobby, and he has a little songbook that he put together. It's only like 20 songs, not even 20, I don't know, 15. And they're all pretty silly. And one day, 20 years ago, I was trying to think of something lighthearted to add to my show so that it wasn't all dark and depressing. And my husband said, why don't you do one of your dad's songs? My husband has all the good ideas. And I did his song about pi, the number, and it was a hit instantly. Like every single show I do, somebody asked for that song. So, and then I made this album, which also my husband said, you should record these songs. And I thought, no one is going to want to buy this. And I was wrong, and he was right. And I got a fantastic New York-based piano player named Andy Ezrin, incredible player. And he kind of channeled my dad in the studio, and I sang. I mean, he was a much better piano player than my dad. My dad was kind of sloppy, but good. But Andy's just a master. And then I had a recording of a live show when I used to play in California, where my parents ended up living. My parents would come to my shows, and my dad would sit in with me if there was a piano, which there usually was, and he would play and I would sing his songs. And that was, you can imagine, I mean, he's a very funny guy, like blew the roof off. People loved it. And I have a recording of a whole, it was a particularly long segment, I don't know, 20 minutes of he and I sort of bantering in a very, the way I've called it, like an Oedipal Sonny and Cher. Like, it's just really, he was kind of, what's the word, sardonic, and I can be pretty sardonic, and the two of us together, and it's very funny. So that is the album, and right. It's called Kaplansky Sings Kaplansky, and people have really liked it.
Would you like to play the song about pie? Or?
I mean, I can sing it. I can't play it. It's way too, I mean, I probably could, It's kind of complicated harmonically, so I've never even tried to play it.
You want to just sing a line or two and tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah. So the first part of the sequence of pi is 3.1415926535897, and for some reason I'll never know, he decided to write a song around that, so the melody would be 3.1415926535897, and I'll just cut to the chase where he actually gets to that melody. So this is the sort of the hook of the song. 3.14.10 my, here's a song to sing about pi. Not a sigma or mu, but a well-known Greek letter too, and so on and so forth. And it's very funny.
Did you say a well-known Greek letter too?
That's what he said.
I love that.
It's very funny. People love it.
Yeah.
My mother always thought I was just being kind to my dad, singing his songs in my shows. Absolutely not. I was totally pandering. I mean, people love them.
Right. So who are some of the musicians that you've been listening to the last few months, few years? Who are the storytelling guitar players that you find inspiration from?
Well, I mean, first and foremost, I mean, if I go back in time, you know, chronologically, the Beatles were huge, huge, the first influence. And then I discovered Joni Mitchell when I was, I think, 14 or 15, the album Blue. My brother told me to listen to the album Blue. I checked it out from my high school library. And that changed my life. And God knows, the way she plays guitar, it's like another voice for her, for sure. And then later on, all the, like, James Taylor, Janis Ian, the singer-songwriters of the 70s, because that's when I was a teenager. And then I think probably one of the most important influences on me has been Steve Earle, who is A brilliant songwriter, B, a fantastic guitar player and mandolin player. Nobody could call him a singer, but boy, he gets the songs across. Mm. That he has been a huge influence on the way I write, and I've recorded a couple of his songs too.
Very nice. Was John Prine important for you?
Oh yeah. Well, I grew up in Chicago,
of course.
He was huge, and I actually saw him play. Let me think about this. I was probably 18 or something at the University of Chicago. He was a huge star in Chicago. Yeah. And, you know, again, I mean, he would be like a Steve Earle kind of guy. I mean, not the guitar player that Steve Earle is, but just brilliant songs and not a singer, but gets the songs across. And then Steve Goodman also was huge in Chicago. And I saw him play at the University of Chicago. I grew up in the neighborhood of the University of Chicago. I saw him play, I was probably 17, and he was, oh my God, he was an incredible guitar player, incredible, and great songwriter.
Would you play another song from Last Days of Summer?
Yeah, well, you know, you mentioned in your spiel at the beginning, you mentioned, I think you did, political.
Yes.
Political expression. Now, I've never been a political songwriter. That's not by choice. It's just not something I don't choose what I write about. I am moved, and then I just start to write. And this song ended up being politically relevant and politically charged. It happened to be during the pandemic, and it was in the lead up to the presidential election, which I had very strong feelings about, and I worked very hard, so did a lot of people, to help President Biden win. And then in the wake of the inauguration and that incredible poem, I'm blanking on her name, but the inaugural poem. So this song was inspired by kind of all of that from an old person's perspective. And so because I actually have a song that discusses politics, and you mentioned it, I'm going to do it.
Please.
So this is called Mary's Window. Mary's looking out at the empty streets of her town. February morning, rain's falling down. She's missing the greetings and small talk there. The library, grocery store, village square. As the baby started crawling, I like your hair that way. How's your mother feeling? Sure is cold out today. That quiet cadence, the refrain of a town. With a cashier, manager, librarian, the sound of goodwill, kindness and care. And Mary knew she'd always belong there. But now this country of hers has been ravaged and cleaved. Why all this sickness and hatred and bigotry? Fueled by the lies of the fools who would lead. Lies told for power, malice, and greed. But this old woman's seen troubled times before. When the people rose up to shine a light once more. So in spite of her fears, she'd play her part again. Band together with young and old, women and men. And on the 3rd of November, she stood in that line with a manager, cashier, librarian beside. And their voices of goodwill, a mighty sound made. And the cadence of towns was a nation's refrain. And truth and hope drowned out lies and hate. From cities to farms, from oceans to lakes, and from deepest Georgia, that same refrain that a man of goodwill and kindness and care placed a hand on a Bible and the other in the air. And that cadence infused every word he did say, and a nation heard and rejoiced that day. They'd put differences aside, reach out to each other, lend a hand when it's needed to their sisters and brothers. Return to the hard work of trying to be the people and the nation they still could be. They still could be. Mary's looking out at the rain coming down. But it's a rain of renewal washing over them now. She's knitting a hat for that baby in town. That pretty cashier's baby, it won't be long now till she can hand it to her mother over in town. All the goodness of people can't be put down. It just keeps on. The sound of kindness, it just keeps on. It can't be silenced. It just keeps on. It just keeps on. It just keeps on. It just keeps on.
Whoa, that's great.
Thank you.
That's really fascinating. Tell me about that song. Tell me about the genesis. Well, I think I know some of that song.
Yeah, no, happily, because it actually took a strange path. So I started writing about, I was reading a lot about how much, there's something called weak ties between people. Like you talk to your barista every day. Hey, you know, the weather's nice, whatever. You talk to the cashier at the grocery store. Like these are very important relationships, they're not close, but they're very important for our mental health. And all of a sudden, during the pandemic, those were gone, especially for older people who really had to be careful and stay home. And I was thinking about what it would be like to be an old, isolated person during the pandemic. So that's the whole beginning of the song, that these sort of weak ties were just gone. But then I was also very inspired. I was thinking about my in-laws who are elderly. My father-in-law is now about to turn 93. My mother-in-law is 88. They live in Pennsylvania, which is a swing state, very important swing state. And my father-in-law, for the presidential election, everybody was saying, vote absentee, vote absentee, everybody being the family. Don't go there. It's, you know, it's not safe for you with the pandemic. Don't stand in line, vote absentee, mail your ballot in. He refused. He was like, I am going to go there so that my vote counts that day, so that the former president cannot pull any shenanigans with the vote counts. Yeah. So that was very inspiring to me. And that's kind of the idea of the song where she is standing in line. And yeah. That there's, I guess, also that these weak ties are filled with sort of the goodness of people. I mean, when you talk to your neighbor, you know, people are kind to each other. I do believe mostly that people are kind and good. I do. And that kindness and goodness is a very powerful force.
Right.
And that kind of rose up and elected President Biden, who I think... Yeah. I don't, you know, people can differ on whether he's a good president. He's a good man. He's a good man. He's a good person.
Right.
And that the power of goodness is more powerful than the power of lies and bigotry and divisiveness. And it started out as a very dark song about this woman who's isolated and is losing everything. And then I didn't want to write that song. And I ended up writing a very, I think, hopeful song. And then I just want to also add that I looked back at other inaugural poems, and I just remembered her name, Amanda Gorman. But I also looked at Lucinda Williams' father was a poet. Miller Williams,
Arkansas,
and he, I didn't know, he had written an inaugural poem. I can't remember. I think it was President Clinton. I can't remember.
Because of their Arkansas bond.
Yeah, oh.
That's right.
I didn't know that. It is stunning, absolutely stunning. And he talks in the poem about that we are trying to become the nation that we can be. We are always in the process of becoming, and I was very inspired by that. So that's where the song came from.
That's amazing. You know, you really, I wasn't sure where you were going to go with the opening G to C, but this is, and I don't know your catalog as well as I should, but this builds up. This gets awfully percussive.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of, it has a very, if the word is dynamic range, it really... And when you talk about ravaged by sickness and hatred and bigotry, in the exhibition is a classic photograph of Woody Guthrie with one of those signs, and I bet you know what the sign on his guitar says.
This machine kills fascists. Yeah.
Right. So a guitar is not going to kill fascists necessarily, but it can apprise, it can... educate, it can spread the word, it can it can console. Do you have similar hopes for your songs? And is it too romantic to and far gone and naive an idea to follow that Woody Guthrie model?
I mean, he wrote anthems.
Yeah.
And
literally, yeah.
Yeah. That are incredibly profound. I mean, This Land Is Your Land, it doesn't get more profound. Like, this is our country. I don't think that's the way I write, but I will say, and this is sort of a kind of sidestepping your question, but I'm shocked. I'm always shocked and also pleasantly surprised by how many people come up to me and say X song, especially like, well, The Red Thread is one of them. There's another one, Song for Molly, which is about my grandmother in a nursing home. How much that song meant to them and how it made them cry or it was comforting. I mean, crying is like the highest form of praise I think anyone can give me. You know, if they say you made me cry, I'm thrilled. So I guess what I'm saying is I'm shocked by, even though my songs tend to be very personal, they do, I think, at their best hit universal truths, and those affect people, and I'm very proud of that. So in this particular case, I mean, like, I played that song in Georgia, Mary's Window, the song I just played, and, like, you know, the place erupted when I got to the part about in deepest Georgia, that same refrain, because, of course, Georgia came through for us the last election, and hopefully will again. Normally, you know, politically, my songs don't have that kind of reaction, but this one has a little bit. That's my answer.
Well, can we talk a little bit about the structure of the song and what you do guitar-wise?
Yeah.
Again, I was struck in the bridge that you threw in that F chord, which there's a certain point which, you know, kind of takes it in a different way. Can you talk about the role of percussion in this song?
Well, yes. So finish your question. And then.
No, that's...
Well, okay, so I full disclosure, I realized as soon as I started playing the song that I was inspired. I don't remember the song that Bruce Springsteen played, but it was also part of the whole inaugural thing. He was standing in front, he was standing in the freezing cold, like wearing a leather jacket, playing, I can't remember what song, but I think it had that rhythm. Something like that. Which isn't easy for me to play. Or actually, I can play it, but to play it and sing it, then to sing at the same time, right. That actually took some practice. But he was playing that rhythm, whatever song he was doing, and I thought, that's so cool.
Is this, I'm hesitant to call it a political song.
Oh, you can call it. I mean, I think it is. Partly, anyway.
This can't be your first political song.
No, it's not, but... No, there's another one, actually, probably more, but the one that comes to mind is Line in the Sand. The hook is, oh, the promised land is just across another line in the sand. And that was my husband's idea. He wrote that line, and that was about the Middle East. And that's a very political song.
Sure. I'm sure. Another thing the song does... As you were saying, it has you assuming a persona of people a lot older than you.
Yeah, which I don't usually do.
John Prine was great at that.
Yeah.
Donald and Lydia and...
Hello in there.
Right, yeah.
Absolutely.
On your website and elsewhere, lots of photographs of you, some taken by others, some I'm sure you've had taken. Do you usually pose with your guitar?
For like publicity shots?
Yeah.
Probably about half of them I do. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Yes. It depends. Yes. I think the answer is yes. Not always. Let's put it that way.
I look forward to walking with you through the exhibition and getting your reactions to some others. Sometimes when people pose with a guitar, it's almost like, well, it's their profession. Sometimes they're just maybe a guitar and a daguerreotypist, an old photographer's studio, and one poses with it. What do you think it says when someone poses with a guitar? And maybe not you, because it's your profession, so of course you're going to. But what do you think, symbolism-wise, the guitar says in a photograph or a painting?
I guess that the guitar is an integral part of who they are.
Right.
Which it probably is. I mean, Picasso has the guitar paintings, right?
He has the blue guitars. Yeah. Lots. It's in all kinds of cubism.
Right. I don't know much about Picasso, but I don't know if those weren't self-portraits, were they?
I don't believe so.
Right. So somebody, either it was in his head or somebody was posing, and I always just would assume that it was someone who was a musician and who needed the guitar to express themselves.
I think that, MoMA has the famous painting, the three musicians. It's very kind of patchwork, cubism, bold colors, and whatnot. So what kind of things might, if I can just sort of put you a little bit on the spot, there's not a right answer to this, of course. I'd just be curious, what does somebody gain by playing with the good guitar? Does it give them a bit of gravitas? Does it make them more accessible? Or is it a way to hide a little bit?
Well, I mean, I could probably mean all kinds of things. It could be a way of hiding. It could be a way of expressing a part of themselves, like I am a musician. It could be an expression of affection for the instrument, like, you know, this is a part of me and I love it. So I guess it could be all kinds of things. It depends what the artist, what's in the artist's mind.
I spoke to one of the lenders to this exhibition is the famous George Grun. And I was speaking with him, and he referred to guitars as living mechanisms.
Living mechanisms.
Well, they have a life, all their own.
That's true.
Would you agree with that? In a certain sense, is there something alive about a good guitar?
Well, so in the sense, they're not static at all. So like I've got this Martin that I got when I was 18. That has just gotten better over time. And I mean, they literally change over the years. So like, for instance, there are guitars that friends of mine have, like from 1945, my friend Patty Larkin has a 1947 Martin, and it's just gotten better and it's infinitely more valuable, but it's also just gotten better and warmer and richer and deeper sounding. So I think they do have a lifespan, because I guess eventually, a couple hundred years from now, maybe that guitar will fall apart. So they probably do have some kind of lifespan, as if they're kind of, they sound one way and then they develop and they sound different and then they sound even more different. Yeah.
Right. I wonder if Willie Nelson's Martin will ever really fall apart.
Maybe not. I mean, one wonders.
Every time one sees him play that.
Yes.
Would you like to take us out with one additional song?
Sure. Well, okay, sure. I would love to. Okay. Well, I'm going to just play this is like my most popular song, so that's worth something. And what can I say about it? It's a story, and it's basically a true story. It's the story of the night I met my husband. And I was trying to, this is one of my first songs, really, and I was trying to write kind of a love song without using any cliches, which is not so easy. And I think I did a pretty good job, and people like it, so. There is no one else around, the road is quiet, the only sound is when the sounds like cars sound like breathing. Desert air is hot and dry, two lanes weaving earth and sky. Stars are all that's keeping time to morning. And I turn and look beside me, and you're sleeping like a baby, and you haven't heard a word I've been saying. And the way you look tonight, fast asleep in the dashboard light, well, I can't speak. and that's how I feel. Open your eyes and look at me, look at me. Open your eyes and look at me, 'cause I haven't held this love for you before this 10-year night is through. I'm telling you, take it from me. Take it from me. We're 10 years older, I know we are, than the night we met in that downtown bar. You thought I was some kind of star, that's what you said. Felt your skin, felt the heat as you pulled me out into the street. Kissed me there till I was weak, 'cause I asked you to. Later on your kitchen floor, two flights above the grocery store, felt things I never felt before, and I still do. Open your eyes and look at me, look at me. Open your eyes and look at me, 'cause I haven't held this love for you before this 10-year night is through. I'm telling you, take it from me. Take it from me. Going 80 on the highway, we're all rushing somewhere, but the way I feel tonight, it's like I'm already there. Open your eyes, look at me, look at me. Open your eyes, look at me, 'cause I haven't hold this love for you before this 10-year night is through. Oh, I'm telling you, telling you, take it from me, take it from me.